Good morning, good afternoon, everyone. Just be starting in just a minute or two. We can just still see quite a few people are still coming into the meeting, so we'll just give people a minute or two to get together and then we'll kick things off. Right, folks, let's get going though. So good morning, good afternoon, depending where in the world you are. Last check, I think we've got something like 10 different countries people on. So wherever you are, thank you for joining us. I'm Nick Johnson, CEO and founder at Apps Anywhere. And there's so much exciting stuff going on here at the moment. And it gives me great pleasure for us to share this with you today. In the last 12 months, we have pretty much doubled our development capacity. And we're about to add some more into that as we look to accelerate the development of Apps Anywhere, delivering far more into the product that you, our customers want from us. And everything that we do is about our customers and higher education. So your feedback is massively important to us. Some quick housekeeping before we get going. If anyone has any questions or comments, please feel free to use the chat facilities in that toolbar on my right, maybe your right, but use the chat facilities there to ask questions. If we can answer them as we go, we will do. If not, we will take questions at the end, so feel free to ask questions as we go along. So without further ado, I'll introduce you to the team. So we're going to start with Spencer, our product owner of Apps Anywhere, and then Lewis, our UI lead, will provide a demonstration of some of the new functionality. And last but not least, James, our development manager, will add some further context and some other updates. And as I said at the end, we'll answer any questions if people may have. Again, thanks for joining us and hand over to Spencer. Thank you, Spencer.
Thanks, Nick. Good day, everyone. Great to have so many people attend today and really excited to share with you what's happening with Apps Anywhere over the forthcoming weeks and months. So the first thing I'm going to do today is kind of give you a flavor of kind of where we're taking Apps Anywhere, the product, and what we're actually doing to kind of shape our roadmap and some of the things that underpin it. So I'd like to share with you our four product pillars, which kind of are the core things that matter to us when we're thinking about how we take Apps Anywhere forward. So I'm going to go through these briefly. We've got the UI and user experience. So obviously it's key to making Apps Anywhere successful is to optimize that user experience for the front user, the students, and also the administrator of the product as well. And we're going to share some really exciting things that we've been doing in that space. And Lewis is going to be able to demonstrate some of that for you today. Delivery methods are really important. So obviously we already give you many options, many different kind of permutations and methods of getting an application to a student. We're going to be increasing the number of delivery methods in the forthcoming months. And we're also going to improve some of the integrations that we already have. So that's obviously a key part of how Apps Anywhere delivers value. Thirdly, higher education is obviously core to our business. We want to make sure any use cases that we deliver have an educational slant on them. We don't want to just do cool stuff. Obviously, we do cool stuff, but we want to make sure that this is relevant to kind of our core user base. And then finally, analytics and data are essential for making great decisions. We recognize that. We already have some analytics capability within Apps Anywhere, the product today, but we're going to be improving on that, making it easy to understand what's happening, how it's being used, kind of to enable great decisions and to kind of hopefully make your lives easier. So if they're sort of key to the product, what is it that we're actually doing? Well, here's kind of the roadmap at a very high level. So we're going to share quite a bit about this first milestone on this slide with you right now. So in this very month, we are releasing our version 2.12, the next iteration of Apps Anywhere. And Lewis is going to do a demonstration of some of the key changes that we've made and that you'll be able to kind of take and utilize in this next version. So that will be the next thing. There are two other key milestones on here. I'm going to save them till later in the presentation. So let's dive straight into version 2.12. I'm going to hand over to Lewis. He's got some really exciting things to share with you. So I'll just take the ownership. There you go, Lewis. It should be yours now. You can do your demonstration.
Thank you. Hopefully everyone can see my screen. So, welcome to the new Apps Anywhere. Those of you who are familiar with previous versions of Apps Anywhere will know that until now, we've kind of focused on a grid view of apps. And we've kind of rethought that for this version. This is a whole new screen. This is our search or home screen. And we've done this because we think search is the quickest and easiest way to find an app that you need in most instances. It also reflects some architectural changes that we've made. For example, with the search applications load as needed instead of loading up front, which means that it should help reduce things like server load, especially at peak times. We took the opportunity to kind of expand the abilities of the search as well. So if we perform a search, we can see that relevant apps appear as you would expect. We can, of course, launch any of these apps from the search results. And we've also kept accessibility in mind every step of the way with 2.12 generally, and the search is no exception. So obviously each of these search results is accessible via the keyboard, and that does mean that you can actually launch apps with zero clicks now if you search for a particular one. As we can see, if we try to launch Photoshop here, we'll come back to this screen in a moment. Underneath our search, we have one of our new features, which we're calling App Collections. So these are kind of groups of smart and highly visible apps. So there are two types of collection currently. There's favorites, which you're obviously familiar with from 2.11 and previously. And these dynamically update based on when a user adds and removes favorites. And the other type of collection is categories. So the kind of idea of app collections came about when we noticed that a few customers were kind of putting a full stop at the start of app names and similar kind of hacks like that to bring certain things to the top of the list. We figured there must be a better way to highlight some of the important or internal apps for customers. So App Collections lets you add those apps to a category, and then you can kind of surface that category specifically in Collections, which you'll see here. And then a user can obviously launch any of these apps from one of the collections, or they can view any of the other collections that we've got. Now, which collections are visible and in what order is configurable from admin. There's a new page to manage all of that. So we have big plans for collections in the future as well. Currently, like I say, we have favorites and categories, and we are aiming to add kind of other smart groups like recently launched and apps that have newly been added, and also things like most popular apps. So we hope you agree that search kind of is the way forward, at least for most people in finding their apps. But we know that the grid view is still important to some people. And of course, we have included it here as well. With the grid view, we also include the collections that you have defined. And this is what I mean by kind of highly visible. Those collections always appear kind of at the top of the list of filters, and any categories that you've applied kind of pulled out there to especially highlight them. On the grid view, we of course also have categories, but we also now have app lists. So app lists have been quite a popular feature, and we wanted to simplify how they were used day to day for end users as well as course administrators and lecturers. So the original intention was mostly aimed around creating lists of apps that could be shared with other people, and you know, that could be something like the apps that were necessary for a particular course. But we've kind of rearranged things a little bit, and we've made it so that it's just as easy to use app lists for yourself, kind of like a personal set of categories. So if you know that, you know, there's always certain apps that you want to use at different times, you can create a list for each of those, and you know, you can still share it with other people if you want to, but you don't have to. As you might expect, you can view the apps in an app list and launch any of them from that app list. And of course, you can edit the list and add and remove apps and change its name. The next thing I want to talk about is launch and validation. So we've made some big improvements to both of those processes in this version. So as you can see here, we've kind of changed how on-demand validation works. Now, instead of the kind of the big obnoxious banner along the top of the screen, it stays out of the way until it's absolutely necessary. So if you're launching an app that doesn't require validation, you won't even see it. But if you are launching an app like this one, which does, then at launch time, we'll pop up that is required. Now, the good thing about the new launch system is that we can see that as part of the launch. We can begin that validation. And once that completes, the launch will continue as expected. Now, what you'll also see here is a new kind of launch success screen. So one of the difficulties with browsers in general, and especially something that we have to deal with on the front end in the UI, is we, for security reasons, we don't get much feedback on what has and hasn't happened. So for example, if a browser blocks a pop-up window, we don't know that, and we can't kind of action that or give any hints. So what we decided to do is create this success screen. Now these hopefully won't be necessary most of the time, but in this case, it gives us a kind of a message to show what we've done. We've opened this, in this case, the website. And if that didn't work for any reason, if it was blocked, then there is just a button to try that again. Once done, you can come back and close it with either of the buttons or, of course, just the escape key. Now, we've also made a few often requested additions to the user profile menu. So we also have new options for validate and revalidate in the profile menu. And we also have the option to download the client at any time, should that be necessary. If we go to help, so help has had a slight overhaul as well. The main thing that we're doing now is we are providing some extra information when somebody fills in the support form. So as well as the information that they fill in themselves, we also send any recent error messages that they've received from the API. And as you can see here, we send through the device information that we currently know about them. And the aim of those things is just to provide as much information as we can in one place. And hopefully that can help solve some issues that people are seeing at the time. Speaking of device information, you'll see that we have a few extra pieces of information in here. So one of our big new features is app hardware profiles. the idea of hardware profiles is that you can apply a profile to a delivery method and specify kind of minimum hardware requirements for that delivery method to either run or to run well enough for that to be a good experience for the user. We think it's going to be a really useful feature, and we've started with two of the kind of most important metrics. One is how much RAM the device has, and the other is whether or not it has a discrete GPU. As you can see here, once validation has occurred and we know that information about the device, then we show it in the device information screen. So if anyone's having any trouble, we can see what has and hasn't been detected. So the point of app hardware profiles is with certain apps that have high system requirements, you kind of often left with two choices: either use something like VDI, which can be quite expensive, especially for those users who didn't need it in the first place, or you kind of try and run it natively, and those people on low-end devices just generally have a bad time. App Hardware Profiles tries to kind of solve that and give everybody the best experience that we can. So once a profile is applied, those devices which can run the app natively will do so, and those that can't will fall back to, like, say, something like VDI, and hopefully give everybody as good an experience as we can, while also minimizing unnecessary use of other technologies. So if we switch over to admin, we have a new page for these profiles. We've got two excellently named profiles set up here. Now you can set these profiles up however you wish. As I say, there are two metrics at the moment: the amount of memory and whether or not we have a dedicated graphics card. And from this screen, you can also see any delivery methods that are currently linked to this profile, and you can link directly to them and kind of view them or remove the link if needs be. From the app side, when applying a hardware profile, it's one of the options in each delivery method. So if you're familiar with things like app licenses, it's a very, very similar experience to that. We've already applied our minimal hardware profile here to Photoshop, and we know that because the device that I'm on now exceeds these requirements, then we had no trouble with launching the app as it is set up. So if I remove this profile and swap to our impossible profile, so what we can use this as an excuse me for a second. There we go. So we can use this as a unavailable apps. So normally when you're using hardware profiles, you wouldn't see something like this. You would have some kind of fallback for those people who needed it. In this case, I'm just using it as an easy way to make this app unavailable. Now, previously we included unavailable apps in their own section. The problem with that is it could be easy to miss, and it effectively made apps appear and disappear as you were switching devices for various reasons. And we want to focus on simplicity and transparency at the moment. So by including unavailable apps alongside their available siblings, hopefully everything is a bit clearer. You get the same results wherever you are, but at least you can see what's going on. Speaking of an unavailable app, you'll see that we have a new kind of hint to try and find out why the app is unavailable. So again, previously we had quite a lot of information shown in the more info screen of a particular app, and it was all about each delivery method. And you could kind of figure out what was going on from that information, but it was quite dense and quite difficult to pin down a particular reason. So we've come up with the imaginatively named why unavailable. The point of this is to kind of distill all of that information into a few simple explanations as to what's going on. In this case, we have a hardware profile that my machine can't hope to match. And as I say, normally you would have some kind of fallback so that the app remained available. But this is a good example for this use case. So particularly for hardware profiles, you can see the requirements, and if you are already validated, then you can see how your machine compares. So we should be able to validate now, and then we can see the comparison there. And so hopefully this just makes it clearer. If there's some reason why this app is unavailable, you just come into more info and it should explain kind of exactly what's going on. Hardware profiles are, of course, only one of the things that we can detect here. Some of the others include operating system compatibility and then restrictions such as on-site and on-domain as well. So to wrap up, we have kind of given the admin section a bit of much needed love as well, which you may have seen a moment ago. So what we've done in this version is kind of reimagined what admin looks like in terms of the kind of outer wrapper. So we've consolidated the menus so that you don't have to spend that extra time remembering if it was a sidebar menu thing or a header menu thing. And it just should make things a lot easier to find. And we've taken a hint from the portal and added a search for admin pages as well. So you can search for any of the pages and just find the result as necessary. And we've also added a number of keywords to some of the pages. So if there are multiple ways of kind of naming a certain thing or referring to it, we've tried to add some extra keywords in there so that you don't have to type exactly what the menu item says to find it. And naturally, those are things that we can expand upon in coming versions as well. We've also made it a little bit easier to get help. So previously there were links to the support sites and the knowledge base. And then in those things, there were further links to open a support request or to search for an article. And we figured we might as well bring a few of those things into the app itself. So we've got a link directly to open a new support request, and you can just search for an article and go straight to the relevant support site with that search. So there's a lot more to come with admin itself. As you may see on the application screen here, we've made some improvements to some of the existing pages where we thought things could either be a bit clearer or that we could provide more information to make things easier to scan. And we've also of course added a few new pages for managing the app collections, managing the app hardware profiles, and we've revamped the help settings screen to match the new help page in the portal. Hopefully this shows that we've put a lot of thought and effort into this version. And it's something that we all care about and we put a lot of attention to. And hopefully you can see that your feedback is helping shape what we do and how we focus. So hopefully it's something that you'll all enjoy when you're able to get your hands on it. And thank you.
Thanks, Lewis, for that great demo. I hope you all agree there's some great features coming in Apps Anywhere 2.12. Just before we continue, don't forget to pop any questions you might have in the chat on the right-hand side of your screen as we go along, and we can come to those at the end. So I'm just going to talk about some of the things that couldn't really be demoed or wouldn't be as interesting to demo to you, but are still really great improvements we've made in this coming release. So the first one is improved detection of locally installed executables. Quite a mouthful, but bear with me. So this is a Windows-only improvement to our locally installed delivery method, which you might be familiar with. So that delivery method allows us to detect when applications are already installed on a user's device and just launch that one rather than using any infrastructure or installing anything new. So previously, we've supported things like looking at the Windows registry application paths or searching for installer keys. We wanted to open this feature up to cover a wider array of apps on Windows. So we now have added a new feature where we support adding one or more directory paths, a list of those, that we'll search through for the application. If we find it, it can then be launched through the locally installed method. We've also taken the opportunity, as with a lot of the things that Lewis has highlighted in the demo, to improve the user interface, improve the experience for admins using this feature and configuring it. So we've given the user interface for the locally installed delivery method a complete refresh. We've made it much easier to tell what all the fields and options do and which ones apply to Windows and Mac. And the reason why we've made all these changes is because we want to support even more applications via this delivery method. So the next thing we want to talk about is improved Parallels RAS authentication. So for customers who use the Parallels integration that we offer and also use a SAML single sign-on, we now support authentication of the user being passed straight through from Apps Anywhere to Parallels. So if you're logging in via SAML, you don't have to log in again when you launch a Parallels app. So it's just a nice streamlining of that feature. Users don't have to log in again. And that really goes to what we're trying to achieve in terms of getting the best user experience out of every part of Apps Anywhere. There are some requirements to this specifically. We'll obviously include those in release notes and release information we provide. For specific versions of the server and client, you'll need to support that feature. So I'm also going to talk a little bit about some changes, both technology changes and changes in the team, which are going to let us deliver this new age of Apps Anywhere. So first thing is, we're moving to a modern API-driven architecture. So what this is powering all of our new features using APIs that have been written from the ground up using new technology. This allows us to deliver much more dynamic user experiences and features, things like hardware profiles and app collections search that you've seen today, which are all powered by our new APIs. We're going to be moving more features over to APIs over time over the next few releases, but all of our new features are API driven. We're also using industry leading technologies for this new Apps Anywhere. Things like the Vue JavaScript framework or the Mezio Microserve framework, which you might have heard of. These technologies are cool, but we don't use them because they're cool, or that is a benefit. We use them because they help us work smarter, work better, and deliver value to you quicker, more features more often. We're also focusing on DevOps. What that really means is we're investing in new tools, automation, and testing that allows us to be more agile and reduce the amount of time it takes between us having an idea or receiving feedback from you and getting that into the product and in front of students, which is key to the Apps Anywhere roadmap. We're also making some changes to the team to help us deliver this. So firstly, we're investing in our existing team. We have a fantastic, passionate development team here at Apps Anywhere, and we want to make sure they've got the skills, the knowledge, and the support that they need to keep delivering an amazing experience for our customers and students. We're also building a whole new team that we're calling the platform team. Now this team, as you can see in the little graphic there, sits across all the other teams we have. And their role is to create new tools, new process, new automation that will enable all those other teams to create the best possible Apps Anywhere. That's things like our future cloud or software as a service product, also just improvements for every version of the products and every feature that we create. We're also growing the team. So we're adding more members to our great team to help deliver the best Apps Anywhere we can. And now I'm going to pass it back to Spencer, who's going to give you a bit more information about what the future looks like of Apps Anywhere. Over to you, Spencer.
Thanks, James. That's great. And thanks, Lewis, for the demo. So I hope you all agree there's some really exciting things happening in not only version 2.12, which is where we are today, but coming in the next coming months and years. And that's where I want to pick up these next milestones. I kind of gave you a flavor of this earlier, but what are these forthcoming milestones? So 2.12 is exciting. It's time to kind of if you're ready to upgrade, then it's just the case of raising a ticket with the team, and let's look to get you on version 2.12 as soon as you're ready to take that, and you'll get the benefit there to the students of having the latest user experience. Beyond that, what we're going to do is focus on the remaining pillars. So I shared the four product pillars with you at the start of the presentation. So all of those represent kind of value that we can deliver for Apps Anywhere. And therefore, by the end of the year, we're going to release a version 3 of Apps Anywhere. So this is a real kind of moment for us, a significant kind of step on the roadmap where we can kind of say, yep, across all those different pillars, we've delivered really key value across all of them. And to give you flavor of some of those things, so we'll be integrating with new delivery methods, we'll be adding analytics capability across all delivery methods, we'll be integrating with new kind of technologies or technologies you'll already have but kind of potentially want to integrate with, such as other kind of LMS systems we already integrate with Canvas, but we'll be looking at others as well. We'll be looking at things like Amazon AppStream as a key kind of technology for delivering applications and others too. So that's where we kind of then say, right, this is version 3. We've created a step change here. And that is a platform for us to kind of go where we really want to go. So from an ambition point of view, James already touched on this. I'll just elaborate a little bit more. So we want to create an Apps Anywhere cloud version, or a SaaS version, if you like, of Apps Anywhere. So a full kind of subscription model where it's easy to sign up, easy to administrate, host in the cloud, do kind of every bit of feature and value that you'd expect from Apps Anywhere today, but all in one package and easy to kind of take the latest version because it just updates itself as you would expect from a sort of SaaS platform. So that's where we're looking at beyond this year. Once we've delivered version 3, we'll be really kind of kicking on with that cloud version of Apps Anywhere. We won't ignore the kind of on-site hosted solution that most of you have today. We will still make sure that all our features are developed across both versions, but basically it gives it options to people as to what is the right thing for the infrastructure that they have, for the kind of expertise that sits within your teams, and kind of provide kind of options that you would expect with modern technologies. So how are we going to do that? Well, James has touched on some of these already. So this is just to summarize, the product pillars are kind of our compass. They keep me true when deciding what we're going to do with the product. Now, none of that is done in a silo. That's done with your help. So I've had the privilege of speaking to a lot of you over recent months. I've spoke to a whole host of people at the Toronto User Day. I've visited different universities. I had lots of conversations down in Kingston at the UK User Day, and we're taking all that feedback. As Lewis said, I think we've incorporated more customer requests into 2.12 than we've ever incorporated into a version of Apps Anywhere before, and we'll continue to do that because your feedback is paramount for making this a success for everyone involved. We'll do this by also releasing more frequently. So obviously, when we create a cloud version, we'll be able to push changes whenever they're ready. But prior to that, we want to step that up. So as James mentioned, investing in the development team, investing in DevOps tooling, making sure we're automating our testing. We can deliver the latest version. We can deliver features more frequently so that they're ready to be taken when you're ready to upgrade. And as I said, we will do this in conjunction, feature parity between the cloud and the customer managed solutions. We're not going to let one kind of slide. Both will kind of be equally feature rich. And analytics is such a key part of what we're doing that we will make sure that that's incorporated into everything that we build. So any new features, any new integration points, we'll always consider analytics and how we can deliver that data to you in the most straightforward way for making great decisions. So there's a whole host of exciting things there that they're all interlinked. I'm so excited to kind of share this with you today. Thinking potentially you've got questions, so I'm going to hand over to Nick now, and let's see if there's any we can cover.
Thanks, Spencer. Thanks, guys. I know everyone's been working incredibly hard on this new release, and there's so much going on behind the scenes that we're not talking about yet. But I can see quite a few questions coming in, and I will put you guys on the spot and throw some questions at you if that was all right. So in no particular order, somebody asks, can the hardware show PC name? And they're suggesting that they use this to identify the PC and from therefore get a full history. Any comment from that from anyone?
I believe that is the intention. I think one of the things that we already include should be the name of the device as we see it. So I believe that's already there.
I thought it showed the name of your device, actually, Lewis. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. Around hardware detection, someone asks, are there any plans to include the ability to add a check for minimum number of cores and possible minimum processor frequency?
Shall I take that one? So yeah, that's a potential way we could kind of improve the hardware detection capability and the hardware profiling moving forward. To give you an insight into our decision-making process for how we delivered this feature in 2.12, we did a research piece into typical kind of BYOD laptops and kind of the types of devices it was likely that students would have. We did an assessment around kind of all the sort of key metrics that we could detect and looked at where sort of the sweet spot around those metrics would be. And we found that we could hit about an 80% understanding of kind of a capability and whether they could open a certain application based on just those two metrics that we've used today. So the discrete GPU, whether there is one or not, and also the RAM, because you can make certain kind of assumptions around RAM. If there's a high amount of RAM, then the likelihood is they would have a fast PC, just because it's unlikely they would have lots of RAM and a slow processor. Obviously, that's not always going to be true, but you can draw a lot of assumptions from that. So this is the first iteration. We'll see how that works. We'll get your feedback, and we'll we'll potentially kind of add those other things like cause in there if we need to further down the line. But for now, we felt that this was the main two things that would help us get to where we needed to be with that.
Thanks, Spence. I can see someone else has asked the obvious question of how do I get the new version? I think you touched upon this, Spence, already, but just to reiterate, if you want to raise a support ticket and get yourselves in the queue, then we will deal with people accordingly. So that's how to get the new version. Someone else makes a comment about hardware detection and error messages for users. Lewis, as you did the demo, maybe you could explain that bit. The point being that actually that about delivery mechanisms changing the priority order on hardware detection?
Yeah, so kind of one thing that I hinted at in the demo is that the way that I specifically had it set up was that by applying kind of an unreachable hardware profile, that just made the app unavailable. And that was just a tool for me to easily make an app unavailable and show you what that looks like. Naturally, in kind of day-to-day use, we would imagine that that would be perhaps the preferred delivery method, and then you would have some kind of fallback again, such as a VDI, so that if that hardware profile made that first delivery method unavailable, then you could fall back to one or more kind of other options for those people who need it.
Perfect. There's been a couple of questions on, and someone correct me if I'm wrong, there's been a couple of questions on the support mechanism, and I've just answered those by saying the support is on the admin side. So that's for people to raise tickets directly with us, as opposed to being students raising support tickets. I'm right in that summary, aren't I, guys?
Yeah, I'm not sure exactly what is meant there, but there's two kind of things that affect support in this version. One is the kind of updated support form in the portal, which is what users will use, and that will obviously go to the administrators or the support staff for the customers, as it does now. And then in the back end, there is the option to open support tickets and search the kind of knowledge base that we highlight in the kind of admin menus. That's always been there. It's just been a couple of clicks away from admin. So that's something that we wanted to surface in case, you know, somebody who was administering apps anywhere needed help from us, then they could more quickly get to that section.
Okay, thanks, Lewis. I answered that wrongly to a couple of people on chat, so thank you for clarifying. Someone else asked, what's the difference between app lists, favorites, and categories?
Yes, so in some ways they're slightly nuanced, but I think that's okay because we're providing people with options that best suit them, really. So categories are something that everybody has always had, and you can create categories for whatever you want, but it's probably unlikely that you would have a category for each individual course, for example, because you would just end up with too many and then they'd all get lost in the noise. So categories are kind of for your big ticket things. You might have one for, you know, internal apps for students to use. App lists, like I say, were originally intended for things like courses. So you would, somebody would create a list for a course. So the course administrator or the person kind of delivering that course, and they could share that with the students of that course. So all of those students would have access to that same list of apps, and you know, they could, while in the lab or wherever, they could just go straight to that list and know that everything that they need is there. And then we've got favorites is part of collections now. So favorites are for individual users. They might have a set of a few apps that they frequently use, and they add those to their favorites, and then they just have easy access to those without even having the need of searching for those apps. And as I say, hopefully in the next versions we can expand on those even further to just make those even more useful to people. The collections, as I say, are also a way of kind of surfacing some of the most important categories as well. So if you do have a lot of categories, it can be hard for somebody to find an individual one. It's the same with a large number of apps in the grid view. And so you can highlight, you know, a few of those, again, you know, maybe internal apps like links to printer settings and things like that, that people frequently need. And you just, you know, they might not know what it's called, and you can just have a quick link to those things. And it's all just about creating choice, really, whatever works for different customers and different users.
Cool. Thanks, Lewis. I can see there is quite a lot of questions here, and I fear we might not have time for them. So if we don't, we'll come back and just message back on those privately to people. Someone asks, is the validation still completed at login? If so, how is determined what applications are available and unavailable to that user? Has the validation changed, or is it still done at login?
The basic idea of validation is the same, and there are and have been two choices. So what this person is probably referring to is automatic validation. So that is still an option. If that is enabled in the general settings, then as soon as you log in, we'll start communicating with the client and the server, and then they'll just be validated. We've also improved that workflow, so we've kind of minimized the impact on the user of that. In most cases, you know, validation completes quite quickly, and it'll just kind of spin in the corner and stay out of everybody's way. Whereas the kind of on-demand validation, previously people might, if they've used it, we've seen a huge blue banner at the top of the screen that says, please validate now. And then you click on a button and a new validate, and then it kind of updates the apps. So that is what I showed, the new version of that, which is just stays out of the way until you launch an app. So the kind of, with the new APIs, it tells us which apps do and don't need that validation. And so once you try and launch that, then we will just pop up with that message that we saw. So again, you may have seen this in 2.11 and prior with the kind of buttons that say needs validation. We've done away with that concept so that everything is just a nice, easy launch button. And then if that is necessary, that's done as part of the launch process.
Thanks, Lewis. Unfortunately, we're just about to get beaten for time. As I say, we can see there's a couple of questions we've not answered, which we'll come back to on chat or email afterwards. But again, thank you everyone very much for joining us today. We always welcome your feedback. So if you have any further comments or questions, please feel free to reach out to us. But if not, we look forward to seeing you again very soon. Thanks everyone for joining us.
Thanks everyone.